Hey, hi everyone, warm welcome. Let me quickly add all our speakers. So guys, you'll be getting an invite to stage. Please accept that and you can come onto the stage. So we're bringing in our speakers today. We have Dakshdeep, Shrija, Daksh.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
I'm also bringing Priyanjali and Gaurav. Hey guys, thank you so much for joining. Gaurav, you can also switch on your video.
Yeah, I'm just about to.
Cool. Thank you so much. So let me quickly introduce myself and then we'll go one round of introduction with everyone. So the format is simple. The discussion that we have on every Saturday is we have a quick introduction, then we have a few intriguing questions to the speakers to know them well, and then we deep dive into the topic that we want to discuss. Of course, the topic today is agenda-less, but definitely we want to try and learn and benefit out of what we can, what we see as our experiences in organizations. Cool. So I'm Meena. I head HR at AMIT. AMIT is this. This is the platform that you see here. We are a all-in-all platform for to host virtual events and virtual conferences. Of course, we have the capability to host large-scale events ranging from 100,000 attendees. And it's not like you need to go into multiple platforms, multiple links to kind of fulfill an event. It's just an all-in-all one link platform where you can have benefits like backstage, live, social networking, speed networking. A lot of mainstream organizations, B2B organizations, universities are kind of really making use of AirMeet for all of their collaboration and event needs. So that being said, I myself have about 13, 14 years of experience in leading global HR BP across the globe, latest with companies like Capillary and Circles. Right now with AirMeet for the last 8 months, exponentially growing. I'm so proud that I joined the company when we were about 20 and today we are more than 250. So that's about me and something about AirMeet. So we'll also love to hear from our other speakers. Let's go probably clockwise. We can have Dakshdeep introduce him. You're on mute, Daksh.
Sorry.
Sure.
So I've been into HR space for close to about 12 odd years. I was a software engineer when I started. Recession hit in back in 2008 and 2009. Moved into the HR side. And then ever since then, all into HR. Started doing recruitments and then moved into the tech HR side of it. That's where I realized, I think the core passion for me lies across when it's systems and the HR space. I did my master's and then again stick on to the HR side. So I've been, as of now, I've been working with PeopleStrong for the last 6 years. Prior to that, I was with HCL Tech, managing again the HR tech landscape there. So here I manage the overall international markets for PeopleStrong. Anything outside the overall implementation rolls up to me. So that's about myself. Over the lockdown days, I think I adopted a pet. Got a wife, so a lot more happening. So it's about me. So that's about me. Yeah, thank you.
That's good, Daksh. I mean, getting the pet and getting the wife is just so same things. Absolutely.
Both keep you occupied at least.
Totally. I love the entertainment part of it now. So moving on, let's bring Shrija.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I've been with Axio Biosolutions for the last 4 years. We are a medical devices company, basically. I would like to say a business of saving lives. And we were also ranked great place to work recently with the survey announcement. Prior to that, I've worked with Amazon, I've worked with HSBC, and I've worked in the real estate industry. Happy to be part of the group today. And I can assure you guys, it's going to be an interesting conversation based on the backstage conversation that we've had. So looking forward to
Totally, Srija. I love the energy right now. Thank you. So let's bring Priyanjali.
Hi, everyone. My name is Priyanjali. I have about 12-13 years of experience in HR. Started off my career with, I think, global giants like Infosys, Honeywell, in the HR space itself. But realized pretty soon that I love startups. I love organizations growing from small to big and being part of that transition journey. And, you know, that's what I've been doing for the past 6 years, 3 years at Ola, and now close to 3 years at AgroStar. We are an agri tech company which advises farmers on the practices that they should use as well as the products that they should use to get better yields. So again, I think startup in mindset, but over 1,000 employees, 700 of whom are BSc agriculture graduates who are speaking to farmers either through our tech platform or through calls every day. And yeah, looking forward to the session. And I think, like in typical startup style, I think everybody double hats in smaller organizations. So along with leading HR, I actually handle sales for the newest vertical that we have launched in the company.
That's brilliant, Priyanjali. And I love the fact that you are you're in a company that wants to make a change in the globe. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's bring Gaurav. Gaurav is our what do you say?
Our stopgap speaker.
I didn't have a clue that Gaurav was joining, but since Divkiran couldn't join due to whatever reasons, we thought Gaurav would be a great addition to the speakers. And I've had great conversations with Gaurav in the past. I think Priyanjali also. So it's great to have you here, Gaurav. A little bit about yourself.
Sure. Thank you, Meena. Happy to help. And I guess whether the conversation I add any value to or not is still yet to be seen. So we'll let the jury be out on that one. But first thing, very, very pleased to be on the panel with companies that really have a very, very strong purpose, which is not P&L and which is not financial. So pleased to meet you, Srija. Obviously, again, AgroStar and Priyanjali similar on that front. I'm the co-founder of Mesh, where we're essentially reimagining modern performance management and employee engagement. Mesh is another young startup, I'd say. We're backed by Y Combinator and Sequoia, and we're working in purpose building this for fast-growing organizations, the ones we find on this particular event as well. Two things which are very close to my heart are coaching conversations and the very nature of agenda-less conversations. And something that I really miss and would like to learn from the other panelists about is how do you replicate those water cooler collisions, which really were the agenda-less conversations at the workplace. Prior to co-founding Mesh, I was leading HR consulting for Grant Thornton in India and Southeast Asia. And in a nutshell, that particular decade of my life saw me deliver performance management, employee engagement, and org structuring interventions for about 300 companies across 30 geographies. Very, very pleased to be here and looking forward to learning from all of you.
Totally. So Gaurav, since you're already here, we wanted to do a little bit more training to understand you a little better. So sure. I would want to ask the same question to the rest of the speakers as well. So can you tell us something about yourself which is not on your LinkedIn?
Oh, many things. my LinkedIn embellishes way more than it tells people. So my first formal paying job was that of a radio jockey on 102.6 FM, and this was in class 11. Do you want just one, Meena? I can go on.
One more, yeah. It's so interesting. I want to hear more.
My first formal job after graduating from Delhi University was... all right, this is the story I'll share with you. In order to break ice with my colleagues, my first-time team members, who are all fairly senior to me, I joined that consulting firm as a young 20-year-old. On one particular evening social, I actually got up on the table at a restaurant, wore my colleague's skirt, and danced in order to win a bet and make friends with all of my colleagues. Another form of an agenda-less conversation that helped me build relationships that still serve me all my life through.
That's crazy, Gaurav.
That sounds like a big incentive for lockdown to open and to actually have a dinner with Gaurav and try to see if it can be replicated.
Priyanjali, I'm no longer 20. Life's got me better now.
That gives me an idea. So, Priyanjali, if we have to really go ahead with Mesh, we should get Gaurav to dance.
Exactly.
If you're going ahead with Mesh, I'm willing to do that.
And Gaurav, you being a radio jockey, so apt. I'm in love with your voice.
Oh, Lord. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Again, those days are well beyond. But don't mind going back there if I get enough people telling me and validating my voice.
Absolutely. I think you still bring that essence in how you speak. Awesome. So let's bring Priyanjali and let Priyanjali let us know something about yourself that's not on LinkedIn.
I'm also trying to think of some interesting stuff after Gaurav. So maybe I'm just trying to think of all the trivia, right, that you used to tell in college of all the interesting things you've done. So I think one fun thing which is not there is that I love driving. I know I love cars and I love going for long drives and, happened to grow up with two older brothers. So I think that had a little bit to do with it. So I have actually driven a bus, a truck, and all of, just happened and I seized on that opportunity and did that. So yeah, I think that's something fun.
Wow. That's the craziest side of fun now. Sounds good, Priyanjali. Let's also hear it from Shrija. Can you beat that, Shrija?
Guess what? When I was listening to Gaurav, right, that was sort of a deja vu because even I started out as a radio jockey. I worked with 102.6 in Vishakhapatnam. So that was like, okay, something is there between all the speakers, which matters. So that was one thing. And apart from that, I started off working when I was 18. I was sort of selected for a pilot program with HSBC, wherein they were training young candidates who were fresh out of school and all of that. So I think that was something which was different, which made me enter into corporate life quite fast. And that was a completely different experience for me. Yeah. So that's something which is not on LinkedIn, but always close to my heart.
Yeah, I'm starting to think, are all our HR chatterbox? Why are they on radio and then?
Right.
Oh, that's cool, Shrija. Let's bring Dakshdeep. Yeah, apart from your wife, we want to hear anything more interesting about you.
Yeah, so something within order that I love to cook. So it's not only the lockdown stuff that made me do so, but I think all this while the time parents were out, I started getting this, I think, starting when I was in 11th standard. So since then, and I cook quite well. So in case we get a chance, for sure, we'll try and host you guys out there. Another thing, if you see that's something which is there only, but if you see the Lavaza logo on Barista, right? That Lavaza logo I created way back when I passed out my 12th. So one of my connects connected me to them to say they are looking out for a logo. So I was paid, that time I was paid 60,000 when I passed out my 12th to get the logo done. But then the promise was that I have to destroy it out, it doesn't go anywhere. So that's one logo that I did. I mean, something which I feel that when I see at least a shop, I know that's something that might work. But I can't claim it to be. It's just in this forum that I've just shared.
Nice, interesting. Is it going to be legally okay to publish this?
I don't know. I mean, because it's just as an informal forum that I've just shared. Else, I could have actually put that across. It was a nice thing that I got as an assignment during those days. When I just passed out from there, and there was a friend of mine who just said, since you're good into Photoshop, why don't you try and do something? So that was the time, yeah.
Which year was
this? This was, I think, way back, I think 2004, 5, I think sometime around the same time. I don't exactly remember.
Is a very good amount.
Yeah, so I mean, I just got it more as a kind of a pocket money.
Totally. I would have used that for a couple of years as pocket money.
I don't even remember what all I did. I think I bought something and then I gave it to my parents to do whatever they want.
Cool. Great to know. Let me also share one of my interests. So I'm interested in a couple of things. Particularly the lockdown brought the best of me, when I was at home. Otherwise, I never found time. So company says I love plants. So after and during lockdown, what happened was we were in a 2 BHK. And suddenly everybody needed more space. And then we took up a bigger apartment and came here into this apartment, which is a 3 BHK, bigger space, bigger balconies and all of that. gave me enough time to start nurturing, buying a lot of house plants and decorating the house. So that is something that I cherish doing during the lockdown. We also bought a pet. I'm not a pet lover, but then my daughter really brainstormed me for several months, and then we bought a pet. It's a Shih Tzu. What else? I think I'm a big lover of swings. And this house gave us the opportunity to actually put a big swing in the hall, in the living room. So my daughter, you cannot ask her to move out of that swing. She's always there. So yeah, it's lovely to share and know about each other.
So I think indirectly, Meena is just calling us out for a housewarming party as well.
Yes, please come. You should come, and I'm totally waiting for Gaurav to dance. You have a swing to dance now.
giving me ideas, Meena. Giving me rope, giving me ideas. I'm about to hang myself.
All right, sounds good. So quickly diving into the topic, particularly, I think for me it was why this kind of topic really drove me to have a session is I suddenly saw in the organization that I'm working currently, we quickly, kind of growing exponentially. We're having 30, 40 people joining in a month. And I think when we were small, everybody knew each other. Of course, we met, we are a virtual organization, but the camaraderie was there. People freely were approachable, and we used to have a lot of chats about each other's interests and all of that. And suddenly in the next couple of months, I see we are 100, 150, 200, and those conversations were not happening. And we had to quickly intervene to see why people started feeling, some of our conversations are very transactional and all of that, right? Started feeling, maybe we should do more things to bond as a company, because suddenly everybody's only talking about work. And of course, the business is exponentially growing. That means we're already too inclusive into, looking at how do we build the business, what else should we do? And it all becomes very agenda oriented and about the business only. So these are the issues that I started seeing within the company. And I also saw that it's not only in virtual organizations. When I was working in physical companies, physical workspaces, these were the issues that were already there, right? Maybe in a different volume and different structure as altogether. But then these are existing issues that everybody sees. Now I want to hear from your end, right? What do you see as issues that are cropping in the organization, right? What are the non-separatist issues that you're seeing, right? And then we will dive into what solutions or what kind of other benefits we're seeing through some of those initiatives that we have bought. But I really want to understand is what I'm seeing is all, or is there anything else that you didn't, right? Maybe you have kind of witnessed those in the organization when people see that bonding is not happening because of what? So why don't you guys take chances and let me know of what kind of concerns you've seen, what kind of grievances you've heard from your team, just because there's a lack of camaraderie. Can we start with, perhaps we can go anti-clockwise, we can start with Srija.
Sure. So Meena, if you look at the current way of things, right, how we do things have changed completely, right? Whatever we with our 10 plus years of experience, everything changed over the last 1 year, right? Everything went for a toss, whatever we have experimented and sort of worked on. So especially when the lockdown started, that was when we had to put our new hat on and see how different we do things. Because earlier, when it comes to engagement or when it comes to improving camaraderie, you can plan an event like, let's all go for a badminton watch, or let's go for a football match, and or go and watch a movie together. So there are various avenues that you can do. When it came over to this part of the lockdown, it was quite difficult to start off with, because one, getting everybody to be in the same mind space when you're on an online call, even if you're doing an activity, right, most of them are either not connected, because you can turn off your cam and do something else. So there is, you miss that in-person connect that you have with everyone. That camaraderie, you're seeing what other person is doing and connecting with them. That was one thing which we were facing quite challenging. And of course, the day-to-day things like, meeting everybody, talking out things, you necessarily don't go out with an agenda, right? Okay, today I have to talk to this people. When you walk into office, you see somebody, you wish them, hi, good morning, how's it going? So that's how you build that camaraderie and that relationship. So that was also quite missing, because when you connect on over an e-call, you already know, right? These are the things that I want to discuss. Okay, you just wish everybody and that's it. So that's something which I noticed, which was like problematic in the beginning. Over the time, it's quite reduced. And now we are getting used to the way, these new days.
Yeah, totally. I can totally resonate with that. I remember like at least 5 years ago, I was with this company called Corel. They were a big fan of cricket club. Right? They used to run something called CPL, Corel Premium League. Right? I think that IPL, CPL kind of things were very famous then. And you can see the kind of connect people would build. Right? There would be 40, 50 people, boys in the company who may not leave the company because they don't want to join any other cricket team. Right, they want to stick with that company. So that kind of camaraderie, I think we're totally, seeing is lacking when people become virtual, or suddenly when the companies become too large and all of that. I think I totally resonate with that, Srija. Great points. Let's hear it from Priyanjali. So what issues have you seen due to lack of camaraderie, Priyanjali?
So I think lockdown was interesting, right? Because we actually, the first few months, if you see, we saw discipline go up like crazy, right? Everybody was joining meetings on time, right? And but like I think we were talking about earlier, it was that first 5 minutes of, hey, how are you? And a little bit of those superficial conversations where you're making small talk before hitting the agenda, right? So one is, how do you sort of maintain camaraderie? I think that definitely was a problem statement. But to be honest, I think we had a bigger issue in terms of people we were onboarding, right? Mm-hmm. Because that, it was a very busy time. I think, everybody was trying to do whatever they could to, contribute to the organization's success. At the same time, you had people joining in. And, that would happen very organically in office, right? That you're pulling them into meetings or you're just getting them to go across and speak to people. And especially, I think in startups, it is not hierarchical, right? You don't get invited to a table because of your designation, right? You get invited to a table because, people value opinions. And for somebody new, how do you even do that, right? How do you build that connect? How do you build those, build that brand within the organization? I think that's a concern that we saw. And we actually saw early attrition go up first 6 months of, or, first 3-4 months of lockdown. We actually saw early attrition go up, and even, and I think worse is when, 2 months after that, when somebody was leaving, nobody had, even we had not built that connection with that person to really have that conversation to hold them back. So I think those were a few challenges we definitely saw in terms of new folks. And then obviously a host of interventions that we did to sort of remedy that. We can talk about this now or later. But I think that was one clear perspective we saw in terms of new people coming on board. I think camaraderie for older people, I think it was not much of a challenge. Like you said, I think it's just about finding passions. So we realized that, as a company, we were very passionate about food. So, people used to connect around food in office. When you order ice cream for 15 people, don't order ice cream for one. And then, everybody gets in and whoever gets it first gets it, right? So, I think we redirected those passions to maybe creating groups around pets or creating groups around music where people come in and meet. Because these coffee conversations and chai time conversations we tried to set up, but at least in our space it did not work at all, right? I think people were so busy that we set it up thinking that people will want to come in, but that didn't work. So we directed and tried to build camaraderie around newer things and keep the folks connected. I think that's the strategy we went with.
Totally. I think I want to second that, because suddenly when you see people who just joined within 3 months trying back at you saying, maybe this is not the place that I want to belong. And like, what did we do wrong, right? But of course, there are these 80-90% of people who are having fun, who are always coming out there, being your ambassador, telling that we're doing A, B, and C and all of this. But there is always this 15% of people who would come back and say, no, maybe this is not the place I want to belong and all of that, right? Maybe they did fit well in terms of, culture fitment and all of that, but they would say, no, I didn't enjoy. Right, so yep. That's mind-boggling. So that is something, you want to wake up and see what are the smaller nuances you're missing, right? Great points, Priyanjali. Let's then hear it from Gaurav.
Cool. I'll focus on the pain points that I've personally experienced while scaling up Mesh over the last year and under the lockdown. I think I resonate very strongly with what Priyanjali mentioned, which is new folks joining the organization in a remote-only environment. Humans, by their very nature, have a need for affiliation. They want to be part of a like-minded community, whether they realize it or not. And Meena, exactly what you mentioned, this is not a place I belong, is the lack of being able to see other colleagues that they work with beyond seeing just the professional on the video screen. And that kind of helps segue into a trend that was already underfoot, but the lockdown really accelerated it, which is moving from work-life balance to work-life integration. I think gone are the days where we always had two different personalities, a work Gaurav and a home Gaurav. Neuroscience had already started telling us that we are creating that dissonance in people's mind, by virtue of which, they're essentially expected to be a different person at work and a different person outside of work. And that's become virtually impossible when you're literally living at work or work from home, two sides of the same coin. So the second thing from the first pain point of, how do you assimilate new joiners into having a sense of community? And there are various sub items under that. How do they get visibility into the purpose of the organization, into the progress of the organization? More importantly, from need for affiliation is also need for achievement. When you're sitting remotely, and I'll focus on new joiners as well, but this particular problem we started experiencing with even our first employees who we had the luxury of meeting before the lockdown. Need for achievement. Any given working day for a knowledge worker, their engagement surges by 74% if they're able to experience any sense of progress. And it's, not really hard progress that I went and won a deal or I made a particular metric from orange to green. It's sense of progress where if you imagine in the workplace, you'd send a lovely presentation to a client, you'd kind of turn to the person sitting next to you and show off your presentation saying, whoa, I'm really proud of this. And then the other person would be super impressed and they'd validate that progress by saying, can you share this with me? Right? This kind of, immediate, agenda-less, unplanned interactions, which we call cooler talk conversations, kind of sit on the need for affiliation as well as need for achievement. So I'll stop it there in terms of, the new joiner issues from these two lenses, as well as your existing past folks who are already feeling a sense of community, but start feeling a lack of sense of achievement on a daily, weekly basis while, because of the physical distancing.
Amazingly put there, Gaurav. I think sometimes you also see camaraderie and, bond really high with people who work together in the past in a physical environment. And suddenly put them in a virtual environment, they're still able to really continue doing that in whatever way they can, right? But suddenly, when you put two not so similar bound, never worked with each other, but then you put them in one environment, in a virtual environment, ask them to work together, you'll have to really put so much effort to build that camaraderie. Otherwise, bringing that bond by themselves, unless they are like self-driven people and all of that, who are like, who are very chatty, talk about others, who want to talk with others and learn more about things in the organization. Unless you have that self-drive, I think for everybody else who are just normal, I might also have my own mood swings where I am sometimes chatty, sometimes don't want to talk, I don't want to, know about things that I want information to come to me and all of that. I think if you're like that, I think it's very difficult to really bond in virtual environments. Clearly put there, Gaurav, that sense of affiliation, sense of achievement, that cooler water cooler talks. Those are the ones we're missing largely here. Let's also hear it from Dakshdeep.
So I think as Gaurav just covered it out a bit of it, because I think the last year for us was something that we actually wanted to go full bang on the international side, though PeopleStrong, we were there, the presence was there, but then the idea was to surge across there and just to pick up that those geographies on a high. But I think that's one challenge that we faced across with all these things happening. I think another thing that came across all people joining in the different in the local geographies out there, the connect all the way was made more difficult, right? We couldn't travel, couldn't tell them how to do stuff, that impersonation kind of a thing, right? When you go and meet a person, at least you try, you get to know, to tell them their culture, right? Because majority of the office, for example, PeopleStrong is all based out of here, right? So you hardly have two people sitting out of the respective geographies out there. But if you have to tell them actually how to relate to the organization, it's actually evident that you have to go and meet them out. Right. So that's something that we actually faced as a challenge for the first 4 or 5 months last year. I mean, people. Another interesting thing that we saw was we hire people. I mean, one of the evaluation rounds is a psychometric evaluation that we do. So before the final HR discusses it, so we do Hogan assessments. So basis that the personality traits are being checked out. So a lot of people, generally the customer facing roles, the profiles which are there, we generally take people intentionally who are very outgoing, who will be mixing up with people and so on and so forth. We saw a lot of, and people like me at least, who have been 15 days always on the move in a month. I mean, you start getting bored, you start getting detached from certain things, despite of the fact that yes, that culture still exists, you are still linking to the organization, but you don't feel connected that much, right? So initial 2-3 months were actually chaotic. You're purely transactional, used to just log in on the call to say, that's my to-do list for the day, that's your to-do list for the day, what's the status in the morning, I need these things to be done by the evening, then you connect again in the evening at 5:30 to say, where are we against those lists? But I think slowly, steadily, as time has progressed, I mean, a lot of interventions that we have taken that we'll talk subsequently, I'll be happy to share. I think those have improved the overall morale, the overall connect that we have had within the organization, within the teams, perhaps within the team member as an individual as well, connecting with their families, connecting with their kids, know more about them. Right? So there have been a lot of interventions that we have done. But yeah, I mean, as stated by Priyanjali, Shrija, Gaurav, I mean, there have been the initial 3-4 months were actually challenging. The business went down. None of the sales guys were allowed to travel. We were all sitting. Customers still wanted their delivery because they have paid. All right, so they would not bother whether it's a lockdown, not a lockdown. I mean, there were their own challenges as well, because their teams were also unable to come to office, and they also just told us that, guys, we envisaged a 4 months launch plan, now it will be a 6 or 7 months because our teams are not together. We don't know how to operate on an MS team or a Zoom. We just don't know how to do it. So I think there were these challenges we had, I think, and it took us good 3-4 months to actually come back and gear back with our game.
Sounds good, Daksh. I think, yeah, those were all the issues that we faced. Let's also deep dive into what kind of agenda-less meetings have you really introduced or initiated in the organization? What initiatives have really, you know, what kind of forums, what kind of other initiatives have you introduced?
So two things. One, I didn't introduce, but we experimented, end of 2017. I think we started off doing our so-called product design meetings more on the way the product has to come up with so-called no agenda. It was more as, I mean, I'll not call it as agenda-less, I mean, something similar as open spaces. That's one side wherein we used, we tried experimenting, and it actually worked. A lot of things we were able to define our own problems and then figure out solutions to our problems. Right. So that's one place wherein I used it in my professional life. Somehow open spaces is something that I've used way back during my MBA days. We used to have these open spaces. I did my MBA from the School of Inspired Leadership. So Anil Sachdev gave us this idea of working across with the open spaces out there. So that's where I experimented for the first time, and then we did it here. I think apart from that, more from an engagement perspective, I think we and it took us ideally good two to three months initially, because by the time we were figuring it out on how do we do it. I think certain things that we have done is at least once in 2 weeks, we do an e-lunch. The topic, I mean, we just go sit about them. How has been your week? What's the plan for the next week? Are you planning for a holiday? Just about how schools are, how perhaps their kids are doing on the school, because poor guys are still learning. Earlier, we used to be like, and it's a funny thing, earlier we used to be like, the kids should not be given a mobile or a laptop. Now poor guys are just sitting there. So that's the only way to study. So I think we try to get to know people a lot more. We do ad hoc calendar blocking just to have coffees. So we'll just I'll just see the calendar availability, just block it out, just call up the person for 15-20 minutes, do a hard conversation. I think that's what agenda less is all about. The more the agenda, the more concrete the conversation is. You can't generally tend to open out yourself, but I think without a specific topic to be discussed, it gives you limitless possibilities of actually going through and making that heart connect with that person. All right, so moving away from the transactional journey, the way we started off, it was a huge challenge because people were unavailable. People were rather not able to manage their own schedules as well. All right, things were different in meetings which used to happen with customers. They were more demanding. I need more time. You still have those 8-9 hours in the day that you can work. People are still slogging, and then coming back to me to say that I'm just not I'm just not feeling like working, right? So there's too much of workload. The customer is screwing me up here and there. They're just asking too much. What do I do? I have home responsibilities. So I think these sessions have actually helped us. We have started doing it from the top level itself. So Pankaj leads it from the top. We do random coffee sessions. We do random lunch sessions. We ideally do e-parties across. That's how we have been able to connect. I think apart from the more sincere side, which is linked to the open spaces of wherein we do more innovative stuff that comes across, that actually, I mean, if you take that, it could be an agenda, and that we are there in a room, but we don't have a problem statement per se. We have a vision wherein we have entered a room, but no problem statement. We ideally define the problem statement and create it. So these are the two ways that I have experienced this at least over the last 2-3 years.
That's great to know, Dakshdeep. I think that's amazing to know that some of those touch points that you've created, e-coffees, virtual lunches and stuff like that. I think some of the concerns that I've been facing as well, right? But then I also see that a lot of people are super stressed. Suddenly, working from home also means that they're seeing themselves working for 9-10 hours because it's in the name of integration, they have everything now. They have to do household chores, take care of the kids, do the job, get, deliver on time and stuff like that. And people don't see the value of this agenda-less conversations, joining these coffees and socials. We also introduced something called a donut on Slack. Right, donut actually matches two people, and then it blocks your time, and then it says go ahead and have a 15-minute conversation. We also have something called a speed networking on AirMeet. When you just go there, click, it'll randomly match you with people and ask you to have this conversation. I see that not everyone's super comfortable doing it on a continuous basis, right? I see that people want to escape, and they're like, I'll just finish my job, and perhaps I want to go to something else outside of work. So what else are you doing, right? For me, it's more importantly, whatever you're doing, what kind of impact has it brought to the organization? So can you share more initiatives that actually brought more impact on the organization and seen more participation, right? I've seen more failures. I'm keen to know what has brought, a success in your organizations. Let's move to Priyanjali too.
Exactly similar thing, Meena. I think we started off. So I'll tell you, I think we are a super empathy and bond driven organization. So when lockdown started and when things started getting tough, I think we knew that, we need to get back to basics. Mm-hmm. People love working with AgroStar because of what we do, because of the positivity that we have. So we need to figure out how to get back to that. And it was very strange for us because we never had remote work, right? My founders come to office every day. Almost everybody comes to office every day, including tech teams. And, that switch was very, very difficult. So, I think one we realized is that we need to, know people at a personal level. So, like Dakshdeep said, I think a lot of initiatives in the first 2-3 months around, let's say workshops with kids, workshops with spouses, generating a lot of positivity on WhatsApp groups, people to share their family pictures and things like that. And in fact, we had people saying that, I'm getting to know people better sitting at home than at office because there's a specific effort on that, I think, which was awesome, right? And, even coffee catch-ups didn't work for us. I think what we realized is that people wanted somebody to speak to. So we actually pushed the pedal on our HRBP connects. So, you know, that was really not something we were tracking earlier. It was happening very organically. But, you know, we made it a mandate that, you know, what we need to have these connects and, you know, while we recommend managers do it, etc. But this is completely in our control. So coffee catch-ups with HRBPs to discuss what are the problems, challenges people are having. HRBPs quickly working with function heads, solving for them. That is one thing that we really saw it work. And we saw participation for that, right? In terms of engagement and coffee conversations, I think what we realized is that at one end, we were trying to reduce meetings because, you know, there was an overload of meetings also, right? And you're trying to, like you said, manage homework and housework and everything along with meetings. So, you know, I think we've realized, and some of my team members are there on the call. I think what we realized is that people like activities where they just have to show up. They are not expected to participate, okay? Because that's, again, one more thing that, you know, okay, I need to share my view, I need to share my opinion, I need to share my feelings, etc. So we kept it open, and that's why, to be honest, things like music nights and all really worked out well, because it was, you know, just show up and, you know, just listen. You need not be, you know, your camera need not be on, right? You just show up and just listen. And we were also overwhelmed with, you know, how many people participated for that. And then organically after, you know, we had professionals also coming in and playing, and after the band stops playing, you know, employees will spontaneously jump in and, you know, sing some of the songs, and, you know, all that happened very organically. But we saw reluctance from people who participate in activities, which is going to add one more to-do for them to do in a never-ending list of to-dos, which is reality of life today. So I think we've tried to come up with more forums where, you know, they can be passive, and we've seen that more people end up being active because of that.
I totally second that, Priyanjali. What I've seen as successful is something that is top-driven. Right. Suddenly, when the founders are in that conversation, or suddenly when the HR heads in the conversation, you see a lot more participation. People want to come out there and share that fun with you. So recently, we introduced something called a brown bag session. It's just an informal chat with the founders. Come, it's an AMA with the founders, chat with them. And suddenly, a lot of people are joining in, asking all kind of questions, as simple as what you ate, what is your favorite dish? You know, I mean, those were a conversation that sparked, everybody loved. And I think that is when the agenda-less meetings make more sense. It's not like a, you know, tick off something from your to-do list and actually come there and have fun. And after that, and then you push managers and head of function to start continue having that, you know, as a regime. I think that has really worked well in an organization like us. I'd love to hear from Shrija what worked for you. What initiatives did you introduce?
So whatever you all stated, right, everything resonated well with me. Starting with what Meena told about, you know, having this brown bag session. We had a session with our CEO wherein you can ask any question to the CEO. It can be personal or professional. So there were questions ranging with respect to, you know, how do you manage things at home? How did you get married? This was a love marriage. So they were asking in detail. So the questions were quite interesting because mostly when you see in a town hall, right, the questions are respect to business. But here it was completely different. And this was then extended to all senior leaders. So it was more like a jovial session. We started off with this, and our team really bonded on movies. So that is something which I have observed for the last 4 years. So we started off with activities like KBC. And this was, again, not completely hosted by the HR team. So before we even started this, we gave this option out to our employees who want to host this or who wants to participate in this. So there were multiple votes which came in, and then they themselves created the entire KBC format. So it was all in all, you know, good participative event. When we respect ourselves that, you know, HR is going to do everything for the team, that's when I felt that, you know, the participation is less. But when we've introduced this factor to the employees that why don't you host this for a change, then the participation was different because everybody was inquisitive to see, okay, how are they going to do this? So it was completely different because we had the background music, we had somebody who mimicked the voice of Amitabh Bachchan. So all of that added on, it was like a very good event. And in addition to that, we also launched a few mental health practices as well. We partnered with one of the mental health practicing agencies. So that also helped quite a bit in terms of those conversations with employees. let it be in terms of somebody is going through a bad patch of, you know, performance. So we help them connect with the counselors, see how we can help them, because the way we do things change during this period, right? So this also helps in building that connect. So whenever we had any employee has any personal problems, we used to make it a point that, you know, we connect them with the counselor, and HR used to be an active participant to see how things can go smooth for that particular individual. So these were some of the initiatives that helped us in keeping that engagement on for the employees.
That's beautifully put, Shrija. I think, you know, putting that onus back on the employee, that really works. And of course, each organization is unique. Each set of folks that you have in your organization's interests are unique. So putting that onus back on employees and asking them to, you know, come to communities and activities around that, you know. So back in Airmeet also, we saw people who love pets are in a community that talk about their pets. They talk about how to groom, how to, what else you can do. And we also had a pet show sometime just casually, and super interested to bring their pets to show on the video and stuff like that. I think putting that onus back on employees really works, and kind of triggering that common connect people have. Suddenly they want to bond with people who love games, and they want to play games, online games together. So that's a great point, Shrija, to make. I'd love to hear from Gaurav as well. What has worked for you?
Sure, Meena, thanks. Personally, big fan of donut myself, but when we started using it, there was an initial uptick. It does kind of match people and things to that effect. But very quickly, we saw that even donut, most new interventions that you bring into an organization kind of dies its natural death. If one thing, yes, it doesn't have executive sponsorship, but when we dug deeper and we said actually finding out why people have stopped using donut like they used to before, what we realized was that, and I'll kind of segue back to what Priyanjali said, in the initial part of the lockdown, productivity went through the roof. People were way more disciplined. They were actually engaging in a lot more productive work per se, but very quickly we realized that it seemed like productive work, and there was a lot of difficulty in actually getting time out for your own deep work per se, because the number of virtual connects just to coordinate and collate, which was earlier very, very easy to do, that's not a habit or a practice that people were into, especially people who haven't worked remotely in the past. So the first solution we brought there, that, you know, what we realized as co-founders and leaders, was if we want people to actually engage with each other on an agenda-less basis, with the same people that they work or coordinate with, we need to enter into something that we call the culture of writing everything down, the culture of documentation. Because the moment you have a culture of documentation and 360 visibility on the culture of documentation, this could be everyday tasks, this could be big, hairy, things that you are working on, so that people have visibility that this is a big aspect that you're working on, leave me alone. Don't always kind of pick up the phone and check what my week is going to look like. That very moment, we were able to reduce, the number of unplanned or distracting connects that possibly managers who felt a sense of anxiety about where my team is, what are they doing, are they clear about what they're doing, inadvertently were guilty of doing. And that's why, the enthusiasm on taking time out from deep work, then in addition to that, responding to your manager's follow-ups, then in addition to that, coordinating with your team members who you really need to coordinate with to deliver to the manager's expectations, people burnt out very, very quickly. And they, even though initially donut seemed so interesting, I can ask my co-founder what's his favorite photograph, or I can ask, my leader what's his favorite food. They wanted to finish these three buckets and get back with their family, which was behind that door, right? As was that door. So from that perspective, the first thing that we did was enter into a culture of writing everything down. Easier said than done, but the moment you start doing that, and again, you need executive sponsorship from that perspective. You need the manager and the leader to take the first, say, even if it's a Google sheet, saying, guys, here, this is what I'm working on. Come throw in what all are you working on. I'm not going to call you, right? And that's how you create time. The second piece is something that I'd like to kind of, which we experienced, and Amit's been asking, these very, very related questions on that front. We said we can't, as leaders and co-founders, drive the sense and sensibility and the practice around this ourselves. So what we did was, as co-founders, we looked at our span of control. We said, how many folks actually roll up into us immediately? How many folks are we kind of trying to drive both productive conversations as well as agenda-less listening conversations with? And we started breaking up our span of control in order to keep it manageable so that I can realistically have a one-on-one with everyone I work with to find out about, you know, the person behind the professional, to find out about their interests, and also match them up with other people from a professional strengths or skills perspective or a personal passion and interest perspective. And we started initially nudging senior team members who were at the cusp of becoming people managers to actually take on people management responsibilities. And we gave them comfort. We said, hey, listen, I'm not going to ask you to appraise these team members if you're feeling intimidated by that. I'm not going to ask you who to keep, who to fire, who to sack, who to give any bonus to. We'll have a process and a science and something around that. All I want you to do is, be a friendly coach and mentor to these people, because your role is what they want to grow into. And just helping them with their own life experiences and the struggles that they're having at work as an outcome of these agendaless conversations will help you. And in a way, it really helped us actually find out which of our senior team members are ready to be people managers as well. So that was a good kind of side benefit of all of this. But in a nutshell, what I'm saying is two things that really helped us make time and increase adoption of agendaless catch-ups. Number one, entering into a transparent culture of writing everything down. And you can choose what dimension is important for you, right? And the second one is a simple thing of looking at your employee master and seeing the span of control for every leader from a direct report perspective and breaking that down into a manageable span of control, because only then can you expect these people managers to have these one-on-one agenda-less listening connects. So I hope that also kind of answers some of the questions, Amit, you put on the chat.
Beautifully put, Gaurav. I think this just gives us a lot of solution on how to structure ourselves, because of course a lot of people are complaining about no time, I don't have, when will I do my co-work if I'm sitting and talking to you guys and stuff like that. It's about really creating that space, creating that time, and I love the fact that creating visibility in the organization through a certain using technology or using a certain other solution is going to really ensure a lot of people have more time having more meaningful conversations than just transactional conversations.
And just one quick thing, not an electrical appliance, you can't pull the plug out and put it into another. Getting into radical candor and transparency can have its downsides, but I won't kind of go into a lecture around how to approach it. Just read the refurbed version of the Netflix culture deck. There's a reason why no rules, rules has become so important and relevant in this lockdown, because Reed Hastings just gives you baby steps on how to get to radical candor where you can have complete transparency. So I'd urge everyone who's listening in to pick up a copy of that book and just revise the 2004 Netflix culture deck. It's ironic, right? It's been around since 2004. We've got a huge company succeeding at that, but it takes certain life events like a pandemic to kind of make us go back to the basics.
Yeah, I think they've done that successfully because they've been reinforcing that time and again, right? They kind of tell the world, this is what we are. You want to belong with us, you need to become like this, right? So that's a brilliant way Netflix has really succeeded over these years. And I also am a great believer that you need to keep telling your own values time and again, and reinforcing that in the company so that everybody, either there are only two things, either they have that mindset or they come and adjust to that mindset. So beautifully put, Gaurav. I think I want to open this few minutes for audiences to have any questions. You can also raise your hand, the raise hand feature. If somebody wants to raise hand, they can come onto the stage and ask questions to the speakers. We may have just about 5 minutes. We can take one or two questions perhaps. I think Amit had a lot of questions. You want to come onto the stage, Amit? Yes. Hi, Amit.
Hello.
Now we can hear you now.
Okay. So anyone of probably the guests can answer this one, and especially people who are into a field of business or in a sales organization. And I see a lot of people who are introverts. That's one thing I face in my organization also, and especially techies, right? They do fantastic work, but they are very introvert. Right. So what organization do, in a very real scenario to make sure that these, those introvert guys also contributing, giving you a feedback, and especially during this lockdown time when, your HR guys are not in touch with them, physically, but yes. So how do we make sure, some example out there by any one of you?
Anyone wants to take the question?
I can quickly share my two cents, because when we started scaling up Mesh, we were bringing in a lot of engineering talent, and engineering talent has this general stereotype of keeping to themselves and being very hard nuts and bolts about work. I think first, before we look at introverts, I'll kind of segue from what Daksh said, right? Psychometric testing. When you kind of put someone through a psychometric test and you get a report about what their behaviors are going to be like, those are behaviors in the absence of external stimulus, right? Those are behaviors yeah. which are inherent inbuilt strengths, but what you bring at the workplace might be something very, very circumstantial from that perspective. So firstly, that step of self-awareness through a psychometric test that I have a natural tendency to be introvert. That self-awareness immediately informs the individual as well as the line manager that, hey, I really need to kind of bring this person in. I need to spend more effort to make this person feel integrated. So that's a great way to start off. The second piece is sometimes, and what we experienced was, labeling people as introverts might be jumping the gun too soon. I'll put introverts from a workplace perspective into two buckets. And this comes from all the bad habits we've had as people managers in the past, where as a people manager, I'm your boss, I'm your appraiser, I'm only going to talk about hard nuts and bolts work. In that scenario, even an extrovert, when they bring themselves to the workplace, like I was mentioning, the circumstantial stimulus that they are living, because, hey, this is a person where I only need to talk about work. If I have nothing to say about work, I'm not going to say anything. They kind of get shunted into this introvert personality as well. But for the genuine introverts, as well as this second bucket of forced introverts at the workplace, the wider work-life integration and making sure that you know the person behind the employee code, et cetera, is important. What worked for us, really, and I'll segue back, I keep sounding like a stuck record, is the culture of writing everything down. Now, earlier I was talking about the culture of writing everything down from what am I working on, what my boss is working on or expecting me to do or something of that sort. Here's culture of writing everything down, not from my experience or what I enjoyed doing or what someone else did which I found really great or how someone else helped me out. You'll see that introverts may feel apprehensive in coming onto a video call and unmuting and saying, hey, Meena, thanks a ton. What you sent me last week really helped me out. I don't want to say it across five other people. But if you give them the opportunity to write this down, they'll write it down immediately. And they don't mind what they're writing down from this perspective to be visible to everyone. So that's how you start actually catering to not just introverts who would love to come on town halls, unmute, share experiences in front of 50 other people on the call and don't feel shy doing that. If the culture of writing actually helps you become aware of those thoughts, those insights, or those moments of truth and aha experiences that introverts have. Does that kind of help answer your question, Amit, a little bit?
Yeah, thank you so much for this insight. So this gives me one more curious question to pop up in my mind is, if that is thing, how many managers, organizations are making to think about that, or the HR responsibility per se, but I think it's a responsibility of organizations. So how many companies, how many organizations, how to do that?
I'd like to take that question quickly. At Airmeet, what we've done is, I know we are hiring a lot of tech talent. Not just the tech talent, I also see a lot of other folks also. You really cannot stereotype people, but then there are people who want to keep things to themselves, but may not want to come onto the stage. They're not like so vibrant or so enthu to come onto the stage, appreciate people, let people know that what they've done and what they think about others, right? So we've given provisioned two or three different initiatives for the same thing. For example, if there is a shout out and appreciation to be given, so we call people during all hands and ask them to come onto the video and give appreciation. We also give across circulate a form across with everybody who don't want to come onto the stage so that they can write those appreciations, and we will call it out, right? We will put it in a nice slide and fancy, we'll make a fancy video out of it and then show it there. So this gives enough, opportunity to people who are introvert and extrovert to do the same thing in the way they want. you see where I'm coming from. So you can actually apply this in multiple other initiatives that you want to do. That's just one example from my end.
I would also like to add on one more point, Meena. So I've seen this in my team, in my design team. So designers are essentially creative people, right? They like to be in their own silos. They would not like to come out and, you know, get themselves marketed back. So what I have seen is when they get into the shell kind of an atmosphere, right? Whenever there are events, we launch something called as an ideathon, hackathon, wherein people have to come up with new ideas in terms of how a new product can be made or what else can Axio get into. So when we launched that, we segmented the groups and we ensured that each group had a designer in it. So this designer was sort of leading the conversation because ultimately for the product, for the idea to come into life, you need a design, right? So then they were indirectly leading that conversation. So this was one initiative we thought, especially because we wanted our designers to come forward and get out of that silo mode. So this really worked out for us. Maybe not asking them to go on the stage and host the event, but at least in their own individual groups, right, make them feel more active, come out of that silo kind of a mindset.
Brilliant, Srija. That's great.
I just want to add one thing here, maybe not directly correlated, but it's not just about introverts, right? I think everybody has different communication styles. And that really comes into play when you're remote working. So one cool thing that we have tried to do at a leadership level is we all of us have our working with me documents. So, you know, it's a user guide that we have written in terms of, you know, how do we like to operate, right? What is our preferred communication mechanism, you know? Do we like to be updated on tasks or not, right? And starting from my founders, we have written it. And we encourage people to write theirs, right? Because classic, it's not about a engine. So I have had senior leaders who have come in and, you know, we are so much about communication. And maybe, you know, like my founders like to be updated on stuff that's happening, right? Because I think we all get energy from progress, like Gaurav, you know, said. And, you know, I had a leader who came in who was doing very well, but just not communicate because the culture that he was a part of, you know, he's like, when the CEO gives me stuff to be done, you know, he should just assume it's done. Why do I need to tell him that, you know, step one has happened or, you know, we got a good customer feedback today, right? And that was causing dissonance between two people wherein, and, you know, it was just about articulating that, hey, you know what, I like to hear about progress. It does not mean I'm micromanaging and I don't need to be in the loop for decisions. But once you take decisions, I would like to see what the impact is, right? Or I like people who are communicate, you know, you may choose to speak up in meetings or you may choose to speak up on groups or on email, but not responding is not okay. You know, it needs to be a two-way conversation. So these working with me guides have also been effective and it's not a top-down thing. We encourage team members to write working with me guides and then, you know, sort of try to figure out some common ground in terms of working styles.
I love this idea, Priyanjali, because especially from a new joiner perspective, if I can open up a document and see, oh, even simple things like Priyanjali is open to endless conversation, or I can call her from 5 to 7 p.m. on Tuesday and Wednesday. Just, this is amazing. I'm pretty sure I'm taking this back with me for Mesh.
Absolutely. I think this is a great point, Priyanjali. And it works two way, right? If I'm a new joiner, I know that my bosses love to, kind of approach like this, or they will know how I approach. So just a simple document to share. And then if you do it without the document, it'll take us 6 months to learn about that.
Exactly.
Right? Exactly. This is just instantly you come and you get assimilated. Instead of assumption, this is what it is. Right? Instead of building perceptions. This is a great tool, Priyanjali. I think you should also share with us if any format or anything that you have, best practices that you might
Priyanjali,
have.
Share your working with me document with all of us.
Yeah. It's quite scary. My founder, Sridhar, he said, I'm not sure if I want to work with you. So,
yeah, exactly. He'll find it scary because he has to work with you. We don't, so we want to see the document.
Sure, I'll share it across.
That's a great takeaway, Priyanjali. Thanks so much, everyone today, everyone who participated. And thanks, Amit, for asking these questions that brought the best out of folks who wanted to share here
so,
today.
So, if we are not running short of time, I have something for Gaurav. Gaurav, because you are running your own startup and you have managers around, and I'm sure this thing applies to them. So how do you, either you train, coach them about, you know, thinking on those lines where everyone is not the same human being, right? Everyone's different. Somebody speaks very well and he could be an extrovert. So how do you train your managers, your team member? What is your stake on that, if you can throw?
All right, I'll contrast this with the last part of my consulting career, where basically I was being paid to run facilitation workshops and training workshops to upskill people manager function as better coaches. And during these workshops, what I realized, and people managers mentioned and confessed as much. So number one, very important to invest in even lightweight, awareness or upskilling for your people managers, especially first-time people managers, in terms of explaining to them that they are not only responsible for execution, but also responsible for development and growth of their reportees. Explaining to first-time people managers that the sum has to be greater than the sum of the parts, they can only succeed if one of their team members replaces them tomorrow. But what I realized, and I ran at least 500 such training workshops, Amit, in my life, and what I realized was managers had two challenges. They all were bought in that, yes, we should have these listening conversations very frequently with all of our direct reports, which are less about us telling them what they're doing well and what they aren't doing well, more about us listening into what they would want support on or what they can do better. They mentioned two things. Number one was the lack of structured program to run this. And number two, the apprehension that they had of formalizing a one-on-one connect because they did not know what are the right questions to ask in that one-on-one connect, and they didn't want to seem like an underprepared or underbaked manager. Any human being doesn't want to, if you put me on a pedestal as a people manager, even if I'm not talking in the one-on-one, I want to be asking the right questions in the one-on-one. So, just like I like kind of crystallizing things into very simple actionables, two very, very simple things. One, making it one of the top three KRAs of anyone who becomes a people manager to have one-on-ones with every direct report as a formal structured process. Now you can get your HR BPs to run this process and monitor this process. You can get your functional lead to run and monitor this process, because there is a big advantage. It's not just getting to know your colleagues. If 70% of engagement issues can actually be addressed at the team level much before that annual engagement survey by the people manager, by creating opportunities in the team. And the piece is, just give them simple script, Samit, that here is a set of three questions. Just ask your team members these three questions and record their responses, and just go through those responses 1 month to another to see if those responses are improving or not. Because that will tell you if you are actually helping them out between two listening conversations, or is that just a compliance driven conversation saying, oh, HRBP told me and now I have to listen to you and I'll document these three questions. But are you improving yourself? So those are the two simple actionables that really increase the ROI on all the investment that you are doing in upskilling your line managers as people managers and coaches. Does that help, Amit?
Yeah, thank you so much. Wonderful.
That makes so much sense, Gaurav. I think something similar that I have also initiated at Airbnb is thumb rules on one-on-one. You just ask these three or four questions and don't talk, right? Ask them how things are going, what went well, what did not go well, and what are your aspirations. That's it. Just sit there and listen to them and record this on your HRMS document, and then you will actually unearth things that you've not heard before from your people, because right now they kind of now know that this is my chance to talk about things that matter to me.
Yeah.
and I can now gain trust that my manager is interested in my growth and he wants to listen to me, right? So the moment you kind of emulate that, that is enough for having this great conversation between employee manager, improving their bonds, improving stickiness to the company, and retaining that talent. That's great, Gaurav. I think something similar that we've implemented. Of course, there's a lot of scope for me to implement something more. And Priyanjali, of course, we're running more on time. We want to close on this, but I really want to see the document. I'm keen to implement that. And having said that, thank you so much, guys. Great having you. Thank you, and have a great weekend.
Thanks, everyone. Such a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, superb learning. We will be posting some blogs around this shortly. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.